Taiwan is the leading nation for semiconductors. Its manufacturing company, TSMC, commands a substantial proportion of the global market. As of early 2024, over 61.7% of the semiconductor foundry's market share belongs to TSMC. This makes them one of the world's most important businesses. However, there's also one company that has been an important player in the global semiconductor supply chain: Samsung. Samsung of South Korea is second to TSMC in terms of market share. The company captures over 11% of the world's foundries market, which also puts them as one of the world's most important businesses. Yet, Samsung as a leading chipmaker is often overshadowed by TSMC and Taiwan. After all, the gap between the two is humongous. But even though that might be true, Samsung isn't far behind. It has a plan to catch up and may position South Korea as the global semiconductor powerhouse. The question, however, is how are they going to do it? How is Samsung and South Korea going to achieve such a bold dream? Well, to understand that, let's first take a quick historical overview. South Korea's journey toward becoming a global leader in the semiconductor industry began in the 1960s, long before the country was known for its technological advancements. At that time, the South Korean economy was heavily reliant on agriculture and light industries, and the country was still recovering from the devastation of the Korean War. However, the government of President Park Chung-hee, who ruled from 1961 to 1979, recognized the importance of industrialization and technological innovation as key drivers for economic growth and national development. This recognition laid the foundation for South Korea's eventual rise in the semiconductor sector. What they initially did was to attract foreign investments and technology transfers from global companies. In the 1960s and 1970s, the South Korean government encouraged foreign firms to establish manufacturing plants in the country by offering tax incentives, cheap labor, and a relatively stable political environment. It immediately became sought after and attracted foreign firms such as Fairchild Semiconductor, Signetics, and Motorola to enter the South Korean market. But that wasn't enough. The South Korean government did not envision the country as a mere base for foreign firms. They wanted their own local companies to achieve great things as well. To do this, they introduced various incentives for entrepreneurs to invest in the sector. A couple of local conglomerates known as chaebols were then attracted by this policy. In the early 1980s, one of these investors was Samsung. Samsung Electronics was already a growing player in South Korea's technology sector, but it had not yet ventured into the highly competitive world of semiconductors. At the time, the semiconductor industry was dominated by Japanese firms, which held a significant technological lead in the production of dynamic random access memory, DRAM chips, and other key components. To change the narrative from Japanese technology to Korean, Lee Byung-chul, the founder and chairman of Samsung Group, made a bold decision in 1983. He entered the semiconductor market, which was an industry that they had limited experience in. He saw a vision where Samsung would become a leader in the production of memory chips. At the time, this decision was seen as a huge risk. Semiconductors required enormous capital investment, cutting-edge technology, and advanced manufacturing techniques, areas in which Samsung lagged behind its competitors in Japan and the United States. To overcome these challenges, Samsung adopted a strategy of forming alliances with foreign firms to acquire the necessary technology and expertise. The company quickly entered into partnerships with major US firms such as Micron Technology and Texas Instruments, which were leaders in semiconductor technology at the time. Through these partnerships, Samsung gained access to cutting-edge semiconductor technologies and was able to fast-track its entry into the global semiconductor market. These alliances were essential to Samsung's early success. They allowed the company to leapfrog over technological barriers and enter the memory chip market with products that were competitive in both quality and cost. The partnerships also provided Samsung with valuable manufacturing expertise, enabling the company to improve its production processes and compete with more established players. Another of Samsung's strategies to succeed was basically doing the learning by doing approach adopted by the country's leading firms. Instead of relying solely on foreign technology, South Korean companies invested heavily in R&D and in building their own technological capabilities. This allowed them to gradually move up the value chain, from producing simple semiconductor components to designing and manufacturing more complex chips, such as DRAM. Thus, by the late 1980s, South Korean firms were no longer just assembling semiconductors for foreign companies. They were designing and producing their own memory chips, particularly DRAM, which became the cornerstone of the country's semiconductor success. Samsung, in particular, emerged as a global leader in DRAM production, a position it still holds today. While Samsung is often seen as the driving force behind South Korea's rise in the semiconductor industry, it was not the only chipmaker to enter the market. Hyundai Electronics, which later became SK Hynix, was another key player in the early days of South Korea's semiconductor development. Like Samsung, Hyundai recognized the potential of the semiconductor industry and made a strategic decision to enter the market in the 1980s. Hyundai Electronics followed a similar path to Samsung, forming alliances with foreign semiconductor firms to acquire the necessary technology and expertise. The company also made significant investments in building manufacturing capacity and focused on mass production to compete with global players. By the late 1980s, Hyundai had established itself as a major producer of DRAM chips, and it played a critical role in South Korea's rise to prominence in the global semiconductor market. Another major chaebol, LG Electronics, then known as Gold Star, also entered the semiconductor industry during this period, focusing primarily on consumer electronics and integrated circuits, ICs. While LG did not achieve the same level of dominance in the semiconductor market as Samsung or Hyundai, it still played a significant role in South Korea's early semiconductor development by contributing to the country's growing technological expertise and manufacturing capacity. A decade or two after these companies entered the market, they have already become internationally recognized. In the 1990s, South Korean firms made significant technological breakthroughs in DRAM production, developing smaller, faster, and more efficient chips. Samsung, for example, was one of the first companies to produce 64 megabit DRAM chips, which were faster and more reliable than their predecessors. This made Samsung become the world's largest producer of DRAM, a position it has maintained ever since. While Samsung initially focused on DRAM production, the company also recognized the importance of NAND flash memory, which began to gain popularity in the late 1990s and early 2000s. NAND flash memory, which is used for data storage in devices such as smartphones, tablets, digital cameras, and solid-state drives, SSDs, became an increasingly important part of the global semiconductor market as mobile devices and digital storage solutions became more prevalent. Samsung made significant investments in NAND production, quickly becoming one of the world's leading producers of flash memory. By leveraging its existing expertise in semiconductor manufacturing and R&D, Samsung was able to produce high-performance NAND flash chips that were used by major technology companies around the world, including Apple. As the 21st century arrived, many South Korean firms still fought for market share and revenue. Yet, it became clearer and clearer that only one company could win and thrive, and that was Samsung. Samsung had maintained its leadership in both DRAM and NAND flash memory. It was investing aggressively in research and development, R&D, mass production, and innovative technologies. But beyond these chips, they had also expanded significantly in logic chips and system LSI, large-scale integration markets. Logic chips are used to perform computing tasks as opposed to memory chips, which store data. Recognizing the growing importance of smartphones, tablets, and other mobile devices, Samsung began investing heavily in the development of application processors, the brains behind mobile devices. In the early 2000s, Samsung launched its Exynos line of application processors, which powered many of its own smartphones as well as devices from other manufacturers. The Exynos processors were designed to provide fast, efficient performance for smartphones and tablets, and they quickly became an integral part of Samsung's mobile device strategy. By integrating both memory chips and application processors into its devices, Samsung was able to achieve greater control over the performance and cost of its products. Samsung's success in the system LSI market was also driven by its decision to become a foundry for other companies, manufacturing chips designed by other firms. This strategy allowed Samsung to diversify its semiconductor business and compete with leading foundries such as TSMC. By the late 2000s, Samsung had become a significant player in the foundry business, producing custom-designed chips for global tech giants like Apple and Qualcomm. The 2010s, on the other hand, were defined by the rise of the smartphone revolution, and Samsung was at the forefront of this technological shift, not only as a device manufacturer, but also as a semiconductor supplier. Samsung's Galaxy series of smartphones, launched in 2010, quickly became one of the most successful smartphone lines in the world, competing directly with Apple's iPhone. Behind this success was Samsung's mastery of semiconductor manufacturing, which allowed the company to supply the critical components, memory chips, application processors, and display technology that powered its devices. In addition to producing components for its own devices, Samsung became a major supplier of semiconductor components for other smartphone manufacturers. Apple, for instance, relied heavily on Samsung for the production of key components, including DRAM, NAND flash, and application processors for its iPhone. The most important piece of a semiconductor industry, however, was the foundry business. Samsung had a similar business to that of TSMC. They were focused on producing custom-designed chips for other companies. In the mid-2010s, Samsung had begun producing 7-nanometer and 5-nanometer chips using its extreme ultraviolet lithography technology. A couple of years later, as the 2020s arrived, Samsung had been aggressively investing in the production of 3-nanometer chips. In 2022, Samsung announced that it had begun mass production of 3-nanometer chips using GAA technology, making it one of the first companies in the world to do so. As a matter of fact, just a year before, in 2021, Samsung had announced one of the most ambitious events ever in business history. They had plans to invest over $150 billion in its foundry and semiconductor business by 2030, signaling its commitment to becoming the world's largest chipmaker. To top it off, they were also building factories left and right. They have the Pyeongtaek campus, which is Samsung's largest and most advanced semiconductor manufacturing complex. The campus has multiple fabrication lines capable of producing 7-nanometer, 5-nanometer, and 3-nanometer chips. They also have the Hwaseong campus, which is another key facility for the company's foundry business. And they also have American factories. One of these is the Austin plant. Samsung announced in 2021 that it would build a new $17 billion semiconductor plant in Taylor, Texas. This facility is expected to focus on advanced logic chips and 3-nanometer technology. The other factory is the new Taylor facility, expected to be operational by 2024. The plant will focus on 3-nanometer chips and is designed to serve major US clients, including Qualcomm, Nvidia, and Tesla, which rely on advanced chips for their products. Samsung is indeed serious about competing against TSMC, and while it is still not the world's largest, it can still become a threat to TSMC. By far, Samsung is still arguably more competent than TSMC due to its financial prowess and chaebol status in South Korea. But anyway, do let us know what you think. Thanks for watching.